WPFA.org.
Good evening. It's Tuesday, September 20th. The separatist leaders of four Russian-controlled areas of Ukraine say they're planning to hold referendums this week for the territories to become part of Russia, with new frontiers that would be irreversible and would allow Russia to use any means necessary to defend its own newly acquired land. The United Nations opens its annual General Assembly of World Leaders in New York with the war in Ukraine a top issue, along with the crisis of an ever hotter planet. The world's body's leader calls for rich countries to tax the windfall profits of the fossil fuel industry.
The fossil fuel industry is feasting on hundreds of billions of dollars in subsidies and windfall profits while households' budgets shrink and our planet burns. It's high time to put fossil fuel producers, investors, and enablers on notice. Polluters must pay.
The independent arbiter asked to inspect documents seized in an FBI search of former President Trump's Florida home, says he intends to push quickly through the review process. Raymond Deary also appears skeptical of the Trump team's reluctance to say whether or not it believes the records had been declassified, as Trump has claimed. With midterm elections fast approaching, some activists sound the alarm over potential threats to voting integrity, to election workers, and even to democracy itself. A new task force on election crises calls for action to prevent election disruptions like the ones after the 2020 presidential election. And Venezuelan migrants flown to Martha's Vineyard from Texas by Florida Governor Ron DeSantis sue him for foisting a fraudulent and discriminatory scheme on them. From Pacifica Radio, KPFA Berkeley, KPFK Los Angeles, this is the evening news. I'm Mark Miracle. The separatist leaders of four Russian-controlled areas of Ukraine say they will hold votes this week for the territories to become part of Russia as Moscow loses ground in the war that it launched. The four regions are Donetsk, Kherson, Luhansk, and Zaporizhia. The announcements of referendums starting Friday come after a close ally of Russian President Vladimir Putin said they were needed because of the war. Former Russian President Dmitry Medvedev said that folding Luhansk and Donetsk in eastern Ukraine into Russia would make their redrawn frontiers irreversible and enable Moscow to use any means to defend them. Ukraine's foreign minister, Dmytro Kuleba, responded on social media and said sham referendums will not change anything. Neither, he said, will any hybrid mobilization for war, if that's what Putin declares. The world's problems, including Ukraine, seized the spotlight today as the UN General Assembly's yearly meeting of world leaders opened in New York with dire assessments of a planet beset by escalating crises and conflicts that an aging international order seems increasingly ill-equipped to tackle. After 2 years, when many leaders weighed in by video because of the coronavirus pandemic, now presidents, premiers, monarchs, and foreign ministers have gathered almost entirely in person for diplomacy's premier global event. But the tone is far from celebratory. Instead, it's the blare of a tense and worried world. We are gridlocked in colossal global dysfunction, said the United Nations Secretary General, adding that the world is in peril and paralyzed. Simon Marks reports.
The United Nations Secretary General says world leaders should have no illusions about the challenges they're currently facing. Antonio Guterres was speaking at the opening session of this year's UN General Assembly in New York. He said the combined threats of conflict, particularly in Ukraine, climate change and COVID-19, are great perils facing the planet.
In the face of such perils, it is tempting to put our long-term development priorities to one side, to leave them for a sunny day. But development cannot wait. The education of our children cannot wait. Dignified jobs cannot wait. Full equality for women and girls cannot wait. Comprehensive health care, meaningful climate action, biodiversity protection, these cannot be left for tomorrow.
Also addressing the world body today, French President Emmanuel Macron, along with other Western leaders, he condemned Russia for proposing to hold a referendum in the breakaway Ukrainian regions of Donetsk and Luhansk over whether they want formally to become part of the Russian Federation.
Nous avons aujourd'hui à faire un choix.
We have today to make a simple choice between war or peace. On the 24th of February, Russia, a permanent member of the UN Security Council, undertook an act of aggression, invasion, and annexation against our collective security.
The French president met British Prime Minister Liz Truss on the fringes of the General Assembly today. She will meet US President Joe Biden there tomorrow, after she conceded there is no immediate prospect of a UK trade deal with the United States amid continuing disagreements over Northern Ireland. Simon Marks reporting.
Hurricane Fiona today battered the Turks and Caicos Islands as a Category 3 storm with winds of up to 115 miles an hour after devastating Puerto Rico, where most people remain without electricity or running water. A representative of Puerto Rico's governor spoke with Senate Democrats today and said it's time for Puerto Rico's second-class status to end.
The difference in treatment in healthcare, the lack of funding for Medicaid, Medicare, the fact that Puerto Rico does not receive the SSI, we don't participate in SNAP. It's at this time that show that our most vulnerable population is treated as second-class citizens, and this needs to end. Our citizens deserve the same support and the same quality of life as their brothers and sisters in the mainland.
Two deaths have been attributed to the storm. Parts of the island received more than 25 inches of rain, and more was falling today. The U.S. National Hurricane Center said the storm's eye passed close to Grand Turk, the British territory's capital island. The government had imposed a curfew and urged people to flee flood-prone areas. It was estimated that the storm could raise sea levels by 5 to 8 feet above normal. The Hurricane Center said the storm was likely to strengthen into a Category 4 hurricane as it approaches Bermuda on Friday. Congressional Democrats today pledged support for Puerto Rico in the wake of the devastation caused by Hurricane Fiona. They spoke at a previously planned press conference called to mark the fifth anniversary of Hurricane Maria's destruction of the island. KPFA's Andy Spivak reports.
The federal government has to help the people of Puerto Rico survive, recover, and rebuild stronger, and rebuild better, and rebuild in a more resilient way.
That is New York Senator Kirsten Gillibrand summarizing the message from Democratic lawmakers in Washington just days after Hurricane Fiona devastated Puerto Rico. It's the second such devastating hurricane to hit the island in 5 years. The climate-fueled storm made landfall as a Category 1 storm on Sunday, dumping more than 20 inches of rain in 24 hours in multiple locations, knocking out power to the entire island, flooding towns, and destroying bridges and other infrastructure. As of Tuesday morning, power had been restored to approximately 20% of the island. Water service was cut to two-thirds of customers, or more than 830,000 homes and businesses, due to flooding at water treatment plants. Gillibrand noted that it was the fifth anniversary of Hurricane Maria, from which Puerto Rico has yet to recover.
Even before Hurricane Fiona touched down this weekend, thousands of homes in Puerto Rico still had nothing but a tattered blue tarp as a roof. Can you imagine what it would be like to live without a roof over your head? It's unacceptable. The government had only completed 21% of more than 5,500 official post-hurricane projects. And only five of the island's 78 municipalities said at least half of the projects in the region had been completed.
While lawmakers pushed for more federal disaster relief and resources for FEMA, New Jersey Senator Bob Menendez also highlighted the importance of managing the relief effectively.
That doesn't matter that you appropriate disaster money if it doesn't end up going to the people of Puerto Rico, if it doesn't create an energy grid that is resilient so that whenever the next hurricane or natural disaster comes, the lights stay on. The lights stay on.
Puerto Rico's power grid was also a focus for lawmakers, who noted the island's opportunity to create a renewable, decentralized grid would create more resiliency and address carbon emissions. Democratic Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer also criticized LUMA Energy and the Puerto Rico Electric Power Authority, or PREPA, after the latter's privatization in the wake of Hurricane Maria.
The situation is a disaster. Enough is enough. The Puerto Rican Energy Bureau must push PREPA and LUMA not only to restore power, but to once and for all create a distributed, more resilient grid, and we will back them up. These two agencies, PREPA and LUMA, cannot stand in the way once again, because you've seen by their inaction the disaster and the harm that has gone to the people of Puerto Rico.
Ultimately, for Congresswoman Nydia Velasquez of New York, the first Puerto Rican to serve in Congress, the federal response is about equity.
In terms of policies, it's about equity. It's about providing equal resources that we do in the United States to every state and to every American citizen.
Meanwhile, Hurricane Fiona continues to churn across the Caribbean, having strengthened to a Category 3 storm and hitting the islands of Turks and Caicos. The National Weather Service does not project that Fiona will impact the mainland U.S. It is closely watching the potential for another tropical storm that could hit Puerto Rico. Reporting for KPFA, I'm Andy Spivak.
Venezuelan migrants flown to Martha's Vineyard from Texas sued Florida Republican Governor Ron DeSantis and his transportation secretary for engaging in what their lawsuit calls a fraudulent and discriminatory scheme to relocate them. The lawsuit, filed in federal court in Boston, alleges that the migrants were told they were going to Boston or Washington, which was completely false, and they were induced with perks such as $10 McDonald's gift certificates. The executive director of Lawyers for Civil Rights said, "No human being should be used as a political pawn." DeSantis's office did not immediately respond to a request for comment on the lawsuit, but earlier the Florida governor defended his actions.
If you believe in open borders, then it's the sanctuary jurisdictions that should have to bear the brunt of the open borders. So that's what we're doing. But what happened was, they were provided an ability to be in the most posh sanctuary jurisdiction maybe in the world. And obviously it's sad that Martha's Vineyard people deported them the next day.
The Florida legislature has allocated $12 million for its program to transport immigrants to sanctuary jurisdictions. But flight tracking data shows the apparent flight originated in San Antonio, Texas, stopped in Crestview, Florida, and Charlotte, North Carolina, before landing in Martha's Vineyard. It's not clear that the migrants ever set foot in Florida. The Hill publication reports that Republican governors of Arizona, Texas, and Florida have sent upwards of 13,000 immigrants to Democratic states in recent months. Since April, Texas has bused about 8,000 migrants to Washington, 2,200 to New York, 300 to Chicago. Arizona has bused more than 1,800 to Washington, D.C. Democrats are calling it a cruel ploy to secure political points ahead of the midterm elections. Some are urging a federal investigation into the practice. Meanwhile, a Texas sheriff says he's opened a criminal investigation into the two flights of migrants sent to Martha's Vineyard by Florida Governor Ron DeSantis. Javier Salazar is the sheriff of Bexar County.
What, if anything, did they sign? Did they even understand the document that was put in front of them if they signed something? Or was this strictly a predatory measure, somebody coming and preying upon people that are here minding their own business and are here legally, not bothering a soul, but somebody saw fit to come from another state, hunt them down, prey upon them, and then take advantage of their desperate situation?
Javier Salazar, sheriff of Bexar County, Texas. Buses with the logo of the Marin Airporter Service were seen among those transporting migrant asylum seekers from Texas to a New York City bus terminal over the weekend. The Marin Airporter takes passengers from several Marin County stops to San Francisco International Airport. In a statement to KPIX 5 television, Marin Airporter Vice President David Hughes said the buses had previously been used by the service, but had been sold to another owner that failed to repaint the buses. Hughes said the buses were sold to a company in Houston, Texas, several months ago. The company said it was deeply distressed that its name had been connected with the exploitation of vulnerable human beings. Texas Governor Greg Abbott, who's vowed he's going to take the border to the Biden administration, which he accuses of lax immigration enforcement, began busing migrants from border towns to Washington, D.C. in April. In recent weeks, he expanded the operation to New York and Chicago. On September 15th, Texas started dropping migrants near Vice President Kamala Harris's official residence in Washington, D.C. You're listening to the evening news on KPFA Berkeley, KPFK Los Angeles, KFCF Fresno, online, kpfa.org. The United Nations Secretary General is calling for a windfall profits tax on the fossil fuels companies to help poor countries prepare for and recover from climate-induced disasters as the planet warms. His call came as oil and gas companies are raking in enormous profits in the wake of energy disruptions caused by Russia's war in Ukraine. Eileen Alfandari reports.
United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres urged rich nations to tax the windfall profits of the fossil fuel industry to help victims of the climate crisis in poorer nations.
The fossil fuel industry is feasting on hundreds of billions of dollars in subsidies and windfall profits while households' budgets shrink and our planet burns. It's high time to put fossil fuel producers, investors, and enablers on notice. Polluters must pay. And today I'm calling on all developed economies to tax the windfall profits of fossil fuel companies. Those funds should be redirected in two ways: to countries suffering loss and damage caused by the climate crisis, and to people struggling with rising food and energy prices.
Oil companies in July reported unprecedented profits of billions of dollars per month. ExxonMobil posted 3 month profits of nearly $18 billion. Chevron, nearly $12 billion. Shell, $11.5 billion. Guterres expanded his focus beyond the dramatic profits of oil companies. He also called on rich nations to pay for the devastating loss and damage poor nations have suffered as a result of climate fuel disasters.
I recently saw it with my own eyes in Pakistan, where one third of the country is submerged by a monsoon on steroids. We see it everywhere. Planet Earth is a victim of scorched earth policies.
Loss and damage negotiations were a sticking point at last year's UN climate conference and are expected to feature prominently again this year at the climate summit in November. Developing nations in Asia, Africa, the Caribbean, Latin America, and the Pacific have banded together under the Climate Vulnerable Forum. They're seeking compensation for the hundreds of billions of dollars of losses they will rack up as the planet heats up. On the sidelines of the United Nations General Assembly meeting, California Governor Gavin Newsom touted the state's advances and its ambitious plans for the future. He pointed to California's focus on tackling the 41% of its greenhouse gas emissions that come from vehicular pollution.
We already have 16% of all the automobiles in the state of California are electric vehicles already, 16%. Wow. roughly half the nation's electric vehicles. And put it in perspective, the Biden administration, to their credit, they deserve tremendous credit. But they just announced for California in their new EV package, it was significant, but $58.6 million. $58.6 million for electric vehicle infrastructure. We just passed a $10 billion budget at the state level. So it gives you a sense of how serious we are.
Newsom also took the opportunity to name check the Republican governor of Texas, who recently tweeted that California's move to ban new sales of gasoline-powered vehicles by 2035 was ridiculous.
And with all due respect to those conservative governors out there, Greg Abbott and others, they're as dumb as they want to be. And they're just doubling down on stupid, and we will not follow their path. We're going in a completely different direction.
While environmental groups have praised Newsom for many of the far-reaching climate bills he shepherded through the legislature, they have knocked him for a few measures. Those include so-called carbon capture legislation and the $1.4 billion forgivable loan to PG&E to keep the Diablo Canyon nuclear reactor operating 5 years beyond its planned shutdown date of 2025. I'm Eileen Alfandari, KPFA Pacifica Radio.
A new study mapping methane pollution across five oil and gas production basins in states including Colorado found a small number of sites account for a disproportionately high level of overall pollution contributing to global warming. Eric Galatis reports.
John Goldstein with the Environmental Defense Fund, one group behind the study, says nearly 40% of emissions are coming from what are sometimes referred to as super emitter sites.
So these are big leaks. These are big problems. What that means, though, is that if we can find them and fix them, we can get a handle on this problem pretty quickly.
The Environmental Protection Agency is expected to release national standards to limit methane pollution at oil and gas sites as soon as this fall. Some critics of rules, including those passed in Colorado that require oil and gas operators to find and fix leaks and reduce flaring, have argued that the cost of implementation can be prohibitive, especially for smaller operators. Methane is 80 times more potent at trapping heat in the atmosphere than CO2 and is a major contributor to climate change. It's also the primary component of natural gas. Goldstein says companies benefit by capturing emissions and bringing more gas to market. He says the International Energy Agency, the EPA, and regulators in states with strong emissions standards reached similar conclusions on the rule's economic impacts.
And again, those state-level regulators have also found these rules to be very cost-effective. And so I think the balance of the information from an economic standpoint is on the cost effectiveness and the wisdom of getting these sorts of standards in place.
Goldstein says there is a critical need for ongoing open source monitoring of methane emissions at local and regional scales to guide efforts to reduce pollution. He says the study's findings strongly suggest that the EPA should model new rules on successful standards at work in states including Colorado.
We're finding less super emitters in the states that have been getting strong standards in place. And that's a really good headline for EPA to see as they're working to try and get similar standards in place across the U.S.
This is Eric Galatis reporting for the Colorado News Connection.
West Virginia Democratic Senator Joe Manchin says he'll release the language of legislation to fast-track fossil fuel projects like the Mountain Valley Pipeline in his state. The measure was brokered with Senate Democratic leaders in exchange for Manchin's support of the Inflation Reduction Act. But today, Manchin said it's no side deal, but was part of a package he negotiated that didn't make it into the budget reconciliation process. And he defended his position.
We do not bypass any of the environmental reviews. We do not bypass those. So if you look at theirs that bypass it, ours that doesn't. With that, we just basically accelerate the time frame, and I think that'll be very clear.
And what do you say to liberal groups who say that your plan will be harmful to the environment, that it'll do damage to communities and...
What's doing damage to the environment right now is the dirty fuel being produced around the world with absolutely no oversight whatsoever, whether it's from Venezuela, Russia, wherever it may come from. The more we can put out in a cleaner fashion than it's ever been done in the world, and we do it better than any place else in the world, that helps replace the dirtiest. That's what really helps the climate.
Mitch had also slammed progressive Democrats who have pledged to try to stop his legislation from moving forward. Climate justice activists were to hold a series of actions tonight to coincide with the J.P. Morgan Chase corporate challenge race to bring attention to the bank's financing of fossil fuel extraction and global climate change. Billed as the world's largest corporate race, events take place in 15 locations across 8 countries and 6 continents. J.P. Morgan sponsors the challenge to get its employees to run for their health. Climate justice activists are urging the bank to divest from fossil fuels. You're listening to the evening news on KPFA Berkeley, KPFK Los Angeles, KFCF Fresno, online at kpfa.org. And we have to stop the news for a moment. We've still got plenty of news to come. This is an hour-long newscast. We've gone through 25 minutes, got 35 minutes left of news to bring you, but we have to raise the money to enable us to continue to do this kind of broadcasting. This is the first day of the fall fund drive here at KPFA. We're trying to raise $475,000 from you, our listeners, to keep this broadcast operation on the air. We don't have anywhere else to get the money. We do not have any commercials. You probably have noticed that. We don't even have what's called corporate underwriting, which sound an awful lot like commercials, and which most large public broadcasters have turned to in recent times. We don't have any corporate influence that way, no ads and no credits to J.P. Morgan Chase or any other bank or any arms manufacturer or airplane companies or anything like that. We are not affiliated with any institution, no college behind us, no school district behind us, no religious institution behind us, no political foundation of left, right, or center. We don't even have any federal money or any state money. We are independent. We're out here all alone, practically, with just you, our listeners. And that's the way it's been for more than 70 years. And every time we open these microphones to raise the amount of money from you that we need to stay on the air to keep broadcasting to you, it is an existential question. It never gets boring because it's always a question of, are we going to raise enough money to keep this station on the air? So, day one on a journey that hopefully gets us to our $475,000 goal tonight. We're not looking to raise that entire $475,000. We are looking to hear from 15 of you tonight who are listening to this newscast. If you can transport your ears over to your keyboard or your telephone and become a financial supporter, we're looking for 15 of you to do that by the end of this newscast. The number to call is 1-800-439-5732. That's 1-800-439-5732, or you can do it online at kpfa.org. kpfa.org, 1-800-439-5732. And if you are listening in Los Angeles, the phone number there to call is 818-985-5735. If you're in Southern California, that number, 818-985-5735, or online, kpfk.org. kpfk.org. If you're in the Central Valley, the number to call is 1-800-439-5732. 1-800-439-5732, or online, kpfa.org. For all of you making any amount of contribution, any donation, we will happily provide you with the fall collection of storytelling for social change, which includes speeches from the late writer and activist Barbara Ehrenreich on women's leadership and fighting back. speech from Michelle Alexander talking about her classic book from the year 2010, The New Jim Crow, and Salman Rushdie, now in recovery after surviving an assassination attempt last month. You'll hear Rushdie talking about his memoir, Joseph Anton, which recounts his life in exile after the 1989 fatwa, declaring he should be killed over his book, The Satanic Verses. That is for any amount of contribution tonight. The contribution can be made online, kpfa.org. Or calling 1-800-439-5732. We're looking for 15 of you who are listening to this newscast tonight who value the kind of alternative news and information that you're getting from this radio station and want to see it continue. 1-800-439-5732 or kpfa.org. As always, I labor under the necessity of raising the money and the obligation to keep bringing you as much news as we can, consistent with trying to reach our financial goals. So we are going to return to the news, or I am at least. 1-800-439-5732. Please give us a call. With midterm elections fast approaching, some activists are sounding the alarm over potential threats to voting integrity, to election workers, even to democracy itself. And a new task force on election crises is calling for action to prevent election disruptions like the one seen after the 2020 presidential election and even during some of the recent state primaries. Christopher Martinez reports.
Voting in the 2022 midterm elections begins as early as later this week in some states, and already some activists are warning of threats that could lead to an election crisis in November, or even in the next presidential election. The National Task Force on Election Crises, a cross-partisan group working for fair elections, is seeing lessons from the January 6th insurrection, election denialism, and the recent primaries.
Well, the threats are unprecedented in scope. We need to match that with unprecedented vigilance and focus.
Wendy Weiser is director of the Democracy Program at New York University Law School's Brennan Center for Justice. She says election integrity is under attack, and not just in a few distant states or cities.
Part of what is so alarming about this moment is actually how widespread these threats are. Previously, it was a lot easier to identify just a few locations where efforts to suppress votes, efforts to manipulate elections are going to take place. But the movement to undermine trust in our elections has gained ground so swiftly and has blanketed the country.
Weiser sees several types of election threats. One is a spike in new election laws that restrict voting, for example, by limiting mail or early voting or drop boxes. In some states like Texas, Florida, and Georgia, those new laws have already gone into effect.
It is because the courts have shied away from issuing relief in advance of elections because of what the Supreme Court's has done in its shadow docket, and expanding a judge-made doctrine that says that so courts should not change election rules before an election. This has actually been interpreted in a way that gives states legislatures at least one free pass of having voting restrictions or subversion measures in place.
Another threat comes from election deniers, meaning people, for example, who claim Trump won the 2020 election or who took part in the January 6th insurrection. The Democratic Legislative Campaign Committee has launched what it calls a Threats to Democracy website. That says that 638 Republican election deniers are running for state legislative offices in November. Weiser says there's been a huge spike in campaign spending on behalf of election deniers running for various elected offices.
More than half of Americans are going to face an election denier on the ballot. There's a danger that this continues to sow distrust in elections, that this could tee up crisis, and this could warm people to election sabotage measures after the election.
Other task force members talked about issues like election worker safety and burnout, and the importance of transparency and good communications to improve voter confidence in election results. Janai Nelson is president and director counsel for the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. She says the threats to the election process are real, and they pose a threat to the ongoing functioning of our democracy.
It was not perfect before 2020 or 2016, and it has only grown more concerning and alarming when we think about the dual threat of voter suppression and election sabotage. And frankly, what I think is one and the same in many ways, that voter suppression is in many ways its own form of election sabotage, of ensuring that the will of the majority, that the diverse and increasingly diverse electorate that we have in this country cannot register its voice through the ballot.
Nelson talked about the importance of participating, and not just by voting in November. She suggests volunteering as a poll worker or monitor by signing up on the website powerthepolls.org. She says everyone has a role, especially given some of the extremist candidates that will be on the ballot.
Once they have the power of law behind them, once they have a title, an office, and an entire state apparatus to utilize to dismantle our democracy, we will have very little recourse. And that is why it is critically important that voters show up at the polls and that they understand who these candidates are and that they understand that our democracy is on the ballot as much as any other subject or issue or interest.
Reporting for Pacifica Radio News KPFA, I'm Christopher Martinez.
President Biden is urging support for a Senate bill that would shine the light on so-called dark money spending in federal elections. The Disclose Act would require organizations involved in campaign spending to disclose their donors.
Right now, advocacy groups can run ads on issues attacking or supporting a candidate right until Election Day without disclosing who's paying for that ad.
The author of the legislation, Rhode Island Democratic Senator Sheldon Whitehouse, said that there's a dark money tsunami of slime washing over U.S. democracy, with virtually no way for the public to see who's behind it. Biden pointed to the recent expose that a secretive Chicago industrial mogul quietly gave $1.6 billion to the architect of the right-wing takeover of the federal courts. 90-year-old donor Barry Side donated all of his shares in his electronics company to the group run by Leonard Leo, who helped select former President Trump's conservative Supreme Court nominees. Senate Democratic Majority Leader Chuck Schumer called flimsy the Republican argument that requiring disclosure of large contributions would deter people from giving.
If the multimillionaire wants to spend colossal sums on candidates or nominees who are deeply anti-choice or who support anti-democracy candidates or who harbor views deeply in conflict with the views of the general public, shouldn't the public at least have a right to know it? The rights of voters and the health of our democracy far outweighs any interest that a multi-billionaire could have in concealing political spending from public scrutiny.
The Disclose Act would require super PACs and other campaign groups to report the source of any contribution totaling $10,000 or more. The U.S. Supreme Court 2010 decision in Citizens United opened the floodgates to campaign spending by super PACs and other dark money groups. Schumer says he'll bring up the Disclose Act in the Senate this week. Republicans are likely to filibuster the measure to prevent it from advancing to a final vote. We are not doing too well here. On the first day of the fund drive here at KPFA, trying to raise the money we need to keep this alternative oppositional radio station on the air, to keep information flowing like you get from this newscast, we have a goal of having 15 of you contribute before the end of this newscast. Thus far, we've heard from Kyle in Los Angeles, Jim in Berkeley, and Randall in Watsonville, and I want to thank you three for your contributions. That's 1/5 of the way to our goal, which is to hear from 15 of you. 15 of you making a contribution either online, kbfa.org, or on the telephone line, 1-800-439-5732. Or if you're listening in Southern California, you're listening to KPFK, you're listening to the evening news on KPFK, and you need to call a different phone number, which is 818-985-5735, 818-985-5735, or you can do it online at kpfk.org. An Iowa man who was part of the mob that stormed the U.S. Capitol believed a conspiracy theory that law enforcement officers would be arresting all the corrupt politicians that day, starting with then-Vice President Mike Pence. That's what his defense attorney told jurors today. Doug Jensen wore a shirt bearing the letter Q to express his adherence to the QAnon conspiracy theory when he joined the January 6, 2021 attack on the Capitol. A viral video recorded by a reporter's cell phone showed Jensen running after a Capitol police officer who was retreating from a crowd of rioters up a flight of stairs. A federal prosecutor showed jurors the video at the start of Jensen's trial. They also saw a photograph of him with his arms extended as he confronted a line of police officers near the Senate chambers, one of the most memorable images from the riot. Defense attorney Christopher Davis said Jensen, a construction worker, was motivated by his 100% belief in QAnon, a conspiracy theory that spread beyond the fringes of the internet to penetrate mainstream Republican politics. QAnon is centered on the baseless notion that former President Donald Trump was secretly fighting a Satan-worshipping cabal of deep state enemies, prominent Democrats, and Hollywood elites. Another core tenet of QAnon is the apocalyptic prophecy that the storm was coming and would usher in mass arrests and executions of Trump foes. The independent arbiter tasked with inspecting documents seized in an FBI search of former President Trump's Florida home said today he intends to push briskly through the review process. And he appeared skeptical of the Trump team's reluctance to say whether it believed the records had been declassified. We're going to proceed with what I call responsible dispatch, Raymond Deary, a veteran Brooklyn judge, told lawyers for Trump and the Justice Department in their first meeting since his appointment last week as a so-called special master. The purpose of the meeting was to sort out next steps in a review process expected to slow by weeks, perhaps months, the criminal investigation into the retention of documents and of top secret information at Mar-a-Lago after Trump left the White House. As special master, Deary will be responsible for sifting through the thousands of documents recovered during the FBI search and segregating those protected by claims of executive privilege or attorney-client privilege. Trump's lawyers had requested the appointment of a special master to ensure an independent review of the documents, but the lawyers are resisting Deary's request for information about whether the seized records had been declassified, as Trump has maintained. In a letter to Deary last night, the lawyers said that issue could be part of Trump's defense in the event of a criminal indictment. Deary appeared unsatisfied with that. He said if Trump's lawyers will not actually assert that the records have been declassified and the Justice Department instead makes an acceptable case that they remain classified, then as far as he's concerned, that would be the end of it. You're listening to the evening news on KPFA at Berkeley, KPFK in Los Angeles, KFCF Fresno, online, kpfa.org.
This is Brian Edwards Tiekert from Upfront. When we're running down a story, or an idea, or a debate, we follow our research wherever it takes us. We've interviewed everyone from the head of California's Republican Party to an insurrectionist making the case for property destruction. The thing I love about this job is the moment when we ask a question and you can hear the person on the other end thinking. They are off their talking points. You don't know what's going to come out next. Sometimes it's profound. Usually it's interesting. That's why when the news moves fast, we take the time to go deep. It's Up Front at 7 a.m., right after Democracy Now! On KPFA.
Thanks to some new donors, Kenneth in North Hollywood, Sabra in El Cerrito, and Martha in Berkeley. We're now up to 7 donors thus far in our newscast. That's about halfway to our 15-donor goal. 1-800-439-5732 here on the first day of the fund drive here at KPFA. 1-800-439-5732. No one calling right now. 1-800-439-5732 or online at kpfa.org. And once again, if you're listening in Southern California, you're listening to the evening news on KPFK, so you want to go to KPFK's website, kpfk.org, or you can call 818-985-5735. In the Southland, you call 818-985-5735. No one calling right now, halfway to our goal. Please help us out. 1-800-439-5732 or kpfa.org. President Joe Biden's contention that the pandemic is over is complicating Senate Democrats' efforts to secure needed Republican support for COVID-19 relief funding that had been requested by Biden's administration. COVID is not over, Senator Tim Kaine of Virginia said when asked about Biden's remarks made during a 60 Minutes appearance that aired a previous day. I don't know what he meant, the Democratic senator said. Some people use pandemic or epidemic or other phrases, but he said that COVID isn't over. The pandemic is over. The way I look at it, COVID isn't over. Senate Majority Leader Whip Dick Durbin agreed when pressed on the fact that the president twice resolutely stated that he believed the pandemic had ended. Durbin shrugged and said, maybe he knows something I don't. Biden's comments soon became fodder for Republicans who already opposed the $22 billion COVID funding for testing and vaccine development that the White House is seeking. The administration's efforts to get lawmakers on Capitol Hill to approve more money have been repeatedly blocked by Republicans. Currently, the White House hopes to have the $22 billion included in a must-pass government funding bill. But at least 10 Republicans would need to support that move. More from reporter Mary Sherman.
Despite comments from President Joe Biden, the pandemic is over, the nation's top infectious disease expert, Dr. Anthony Fauci, warned it's unlikely the U.S. will eradicate the coronavirus. He noted rapidly evolving science and the vaccines have made a difference.
Even though it's been terrible from the standpoint of the toll of human suffering and death, both in the United States and globally, it clearly would have been much, much worse.
According to the CDC, nearly 400 people are dying from COVID each day. I'm Mary Sherman for Pacifica Network and Public News Service.
Of Adnan Syed after overturning his conviction for a 1999 murder that was chronicled in the hit podcast Serial. Circuit Court Judge Melissa Finn ordered that Syed's conviction be vacated. She approved the release of the now 41-year-old who has spent more than 2 decades behind bars. Syed has always maintained that he never killed his ex-girlfriend, Hai Min Lee. The case received widespread attention in 2014 when the podcast Serial focused on Lee's killing and raised doubts about some of the evidence prosecutors had used. Maryland State Attorney Marilyn Mosby.
Our reinvestigation revealed that the original prosecutors and the subsequent prosecutors in the Attorney General's office failed to disclose relevant information about alternative suspects, one of whom threatened to kill the victim and had motive to kill the victim, and both of whom had a pattern of violence against women.
She said investigators are waiting for the results of DNA analysis before determining whether to seek a new trial date or throw out the case against Saeed and certify his innocence. Meanwhile, the creator of the true crime podcast that helped free Saeed said that she feels a mix of emotions over how long it took authorities to act on the evidence that she says has long been available. Podcast host Sarah Koenig released a new episode of Serial today, the day after the judge vacated Saeed's 2000 conviction and allowed him to walk free out of court. Koenig noted that all of the evidence cited in prosecutors' motions to overturn the conviction was available since 1999. She argued that the case against Saeed involved just about every chronic problem in the U.S. justice system. Federal authorities have charged 47 people in what they're calling the largest fraud scheme yet to take advantage of the COVID-19 pandemic by stealing and defrauding the government of $250 million. Documents made public today charge the defendants with counts including conspiracy, wire fraud, money laundering, and bribery. Prosecutors say the defendants, mostly in Minnesota, created companies that claimed to be offering food to thousands of low-income children across the state, then sought reimbursement through a federal program. Prosecutors say few meals were actually served, and the defendants used the money to buy luxury cars, property, and jewelry. This year, the U.S. Justice Department has made prosecuting pandemic-related fraud a priority and has stepped up enforcement actions. Social workers in San Francisco, or school workers, that is, in San Francisco, were to rally tonight at the San Francisco School Board meeting, demanding they be paid for the work they do. The union, representing workers like kitchen staff, janitors, and special ed aides, say the school district's payroll system is still failing to fully pay them, 8 months after problems first arose when the district began using the Empower SF payroll system. Jenny Smith Camejo with SEIU Local 1021 told KPFA short paychecks and improperly canceled benefits for school workers are making the jobs stressful and harming the ability to keep their own families housed, fed, and healthy.
At least 67 who have reported it to us directly who are having issues. So in some cases, it's that they haven't been paid for days that they worked, or they haven't received pay for holidays that they were supposed to get, so their paychecks are short. In some cases, their deductions for insurance policies or retirement have been doubled, which they should not have been. So they've had extra money taken out of their paychecks. One huge problem that a lot of folks have had is that their retirement is being deducted from their check, but it's not being deposited in their retirement account. So their, you know, accounts are short. Some people are actually have not been able to retire when they were supposed to because of these problems.
Smith Camejo says some paychecks are missing entire days of pay, and insurance premiums deducted from paychecks have not been credited to the insurance companies, resulting in an inability to access policies or have claims processed. Other problems include incorrect vacation and sick leave accruals. She says it's time the school district take accountability, make the workers whole.
We really need the school board to intervene and just make sure that this gets done instead of waiting for the system to be fixed. Somebody needs to be in there writing checks to people that are owed money. You know, at the end of the day, this is just not acceptable, especially from a school district of, you know, a large metropolitan area. It doesn't make any sense.
School workers said they would rally starting at 5:30 tonight ahead of the school district board meeting on Franklin Street, 555 Franklin in San Francisco. We're just Three supporters, financial supporters short of our goal of 15 tonight here on the first day of the fund drive here at KPFA. Just three more of you to call 1-800-439-5732. Make any size of donation and become eligible for KPFA's fall collection of storytelling for social change featuring Barbara Ehrenreich, Michelle Alexander, and Salman Rushdie. 1-800-439-5732. Any contribution will get you their speeches or online at kpfa.org. 1-800-439-5732. No one calling right now. 1-800-439-5732 or online at kpfa.org. If you are listening in Southern California, the number to call down there, I'm up here in San Francisco, 818-985-5735. 818-985-5735 or kpfk.org, kpfk.org, or 818-985-5735. The very first day of the fund drive here at KPFA, trying to make it a success. Keep this radio station on the air. Keep this newscast on the air. Native American actor and activist Sasheen Littlefeather has formally accepted an apology by officials at the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences. Daniel Montano reports.
The event at the Academy Museum comes nearly 50 years after she was booed and professionally boycotted for her speech during the 1973 Oscar Awards broadcast on behalf of Marlon Brando, declining his award for Best Actor. Casting director and former president of the Academy, David Rubin, read from a letter of apology first presented to Littlefeather in June.
For too long, the courage you showed has been unacknowledged. For this, we offer both our deepest apologies and our sincere admiration.
Rubin said the Academy is at an inflection point for inclusion and representation. Littlefeather's 1973 speech called attention to the ongoing conflict at Wounded Knee, South Dakota, and called out the poor representation of Native people in popular media. At the recent event, Littlefeather said she understood the gravity of her role that night.
I was representing all Indigenous voices out there, all Indigenous people, because we have never been heard in that way before. And if I had to pay the price of admission, then that was okay, because those doors had to be open.
Billed as a healing event, her appearance included a discussion with producer Bird Runningwater, the co-chair of the Academy's Indigenous Alliance and former head of the Sundance Institute's Native Lab.
And that's Daniel Montano reporting. Animal rights advocates were to rally at the Alameda County Board of Supervisors hearing today, demanding a ban on the county's rodeo. The activists say the rodeo encourages cruel treatment against animals. They were pushing for adoption of an ordinance that at least would restrict certain rodeo practices. And one final plea to try to get three more of you so that we can meet our goal of 15 donors here on the first day of the fund drive at KPFA. 1-800-439-5732 or online at kpfa.org. Cloudy tomorrow morning in the San Francisco Bay Area, clearing by the afternoon with a high of 70 degrees to the mid-70s. Further inland, there is a 20% chance of rain in the area tomorrow. Sunny in the central San Joaquin Valley tomorrow with highs in the low 80s, and a high of 80 predicted for the Los Angeles area tomorrow under partly cloudy skies. I'm Mark Miracle. Good evening.
Tune in Tuesday nights starting at 7 p.m. with La Raza Chronicles, a weekly Latinx affairs magazine program with local and international focus, highlighting the social, political, and cultural events affecting the Latinx community. After that, it's international jazz, Latin jazz, and more on bebop, kubop, and the musical truth with Avacha. At 10 p.m., it's the Reggae Express with Spliff Skankin and Tony Moses. That's Tuesday nights on 94.1 FM KPFA and kpfa.org.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K24 8BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.